This video will introduce different communication paradigms. So a communication paradigm is basically a set of communication primitives, anything that allows us to communicate. So far, we have seen sockets. We have seen TCP sockets and UDP sockets. But sockets are by no means the only communication paradigm. There are other, for example, there are communication paradigms at lower abstraction levels, like for example the link layer. And on the link layer we find the protocols like Ethernet and Wi-Fi, which allows communication using MAC addresses. We have not had to use such protocols previously in the course, and that's because we are using a communication paradigm at the higher abstraction level, namely sockets, thanks to which we don't have to bother about the underlying paradigms like the Ethernet or the Wi-Fi protocol. Okay, but there are of course yet lower layers like the physical layer, which defines things like voltage levels and how plugs are designed. Okay, but now we will look at communication paradigms on higher abstraction levels above sockets. And just like sockets makes life easier than using Ethernet or voltage levels, the communication paradigms at abstraction levels above sockets will make life easier than using sockets. When talking about different communication paradigms and comparing them, there are a few properties that should be understood. The first set of properties is space decoupling and time decoupling. Space decoupling means that sender has no notion about the location of the receiver. The sender does not have to know IP address or port number or anything like that of the receiver. And the time decoupling means that sender and receiver do not have to be running at the same time. It could be that first the receiver is down and the sender is sending whatever shall be sent. Then the sender goes down and later the receiver starts and can then receive what was sent. The next set of properties is synchronous and asynchronous communication. So first I'll explain synchronous communication. So say that we have timelines here. Time goes in that direction. Here is the sender, and then there is the receiver. First the sender is active, and then sends a message to the receiver. The receiver is then active and returns some answer to the sender, and the sender is again active. So with synchronous communication, the sender is blocked here. The sending thread cannot do anything here, just idle, waiting for return value from receiver or acknowledgement that the work is performed by the receiver. Instead, with asynchronous communication, the sender is not blocked but can continue executing here. Whether there is this kind of notification when the receiver is completed or not, or however network failures are handled, that's another story. The important thing with asynchronous communication is this fact that the sender is not blocked but can continue to work immediately after having sent. Then there is access transparency and location transparency. There are other kinds of transparencies defined as well, but we'll just consider these two in this course. So access transparency means that using a local resource and using a remote resource in another network node is exactly transparent, handled exactly the same way. The code on the calling side is exactly the same, whether we're using something residing on the same node or something residing in another node. That's access transparency. And location transparency means that when calling something in the remote node, the code does not change if that something is moved to another remote node. To illustrate the need for a higher level communication paradigm, let's have a look at the chat example, the chat program. So I'm going to look at the blocking socket serialized object protocol version. And let's start with the client. So here's the net layer of the client. Here's the server connection where all communication happens. So okay, what is application specific here? What would be changed if we were to write another application communicating using blocking TCP sockets? and what is application independent would be exactly the same for another application. So let's look at the connect method first that opens a connection. The only thing that is application specific is the host and the port. The address to which to connect, and the output handler, which will handle responses. So all code here, apart from this, all code here would be identical for another application. The disconnect method, the disconnection, these three lines would be the same for another application. The only difference here would be for another application might be the protocol, the message to send on this connection. These methods, send username and send chat entry, are protocol specific, so they would be different for another application using another protocol. But the actual sending of the message would be identical for another application. And the listener that handles responses would be identical for another application, except for the message type of the message received from the server. So we see there is a lot of code here that will be identical for other applications. Let's also have a look at the server side. The server side network code is in the server.net package. So in there is first the chat server class, which is responsible for the server socket and establishing connections. So in here, what is application specific? Main, nothing application specific, just parse the arguments and start serving. In the broadcast method, well, the call to the controller is application specific. How to save state, that is application specific, but not the actual broadcasting. How to shut down a handler, nothing application specific there. The main server loop, accepting connections and starting handlers, nothing application specific. The actual starting of a handler, nothing application specific. We might argue that the linger time and the timeout is application specific. Okay, so maybe we would require the possibility to change those values in another application. That's the chat server. So then there is the client handler that handles communication with a particular client. So in here, the constructor is completely independent of application. In the run loop, there are the protocol specific things, which messages can be sent, that's application specific, and also what to do in response to the message, to broadcast and what to broadcast. That's application specific. The actual sending of a message, only thing related to this application is the message type, the name of the message type, broadcast. And this connection is independent of the application. So all in all, we see that there is very little application specific code here. Basically, it is just the names of the messages and what to do in response to receiving a message. Assume now that we were about to write a completely different application communicating over TCP sockets. How would we start? By rewriting exactly the same code that we have written here for the chat application. Not a very wise idea, would be a waste of time. Copying the files and just starting to modify the names of the messages. Well, would save time, but would lead to loads of duplicated code that were identical in the different applications. And I guess I don't have to explain why duplicated code is very bad programming practice. Whatever bug we find, whatever change we have to do it in all places where the duplicated code exists. Okay, very bad idea also that. Now what we should do if we were to write a different application using much of the same code would be to extract the code from this application and create a new product that contains just the code that is not application specific, and then use that product for all our TCP communication applications. That product, the extracted code that is not application specific, would in fact become a communication paradigm at a higher abstraction level than TCP sockets, because it would allow us to send any message using our own protocol, not bothering about TCP. Okay, but now I'm going a bit ahead of the presentation. We will arrive at that point in due time. First, let's conclude that it is probably no need for us to do this extraction of the application independent code into the new product. It's highly likely that someone already did it. We're probably not the first to realize that different TCP applications have a lot of code in common. Whenever we find that our program contains such code, or that we are about to write such code that is not dependent on the application, which is often called infrastructure code, then we should hear an alarm bell ringing. We should generally never write infrastructure code unless we are very clear that there is the need. Why? Well, because someone already did it, most likely. So we should go looking for a framework instead that does what infrastructure code has to do. There's no need to rewrite something that already exists. New code, new bugs, if we write on our own. No need to write code that already exists. Existing frameworks that are frequently used are proven to work. They have been tested. And there is most likely documentation. We can get help in forums and so on. And furthermore, infrastructure code is hard to write. It includes things like network handling, transactions, security, persistence, and such on, which are tough to write and hard to debug. So whenever we are about to write infrastructure code, we must ask ourselves, has no one done this before? Most likely someone has already done it, and then there's no need for us to do it. That means we should never write infrastructure code. It's just extra work, unless we are absolutely sure it is needed. And why it is needed could of course be that actually no one did it before, there is no suitable framework, but that's not often the case. Most likely we can find a framework. Rather, maybe the need to write it ourselves could be that we need some form of specific lower level control that the framework does not grant us, but that is also not very often the case. So we should be very reluctant writing infrastructure code. To again be a bit more socket specific, the main reasons to use sockets instead of a framework on some higher abstraction level could be the following. Maybe we want full control of some specific TCP option that the framework does not grant us. Maybe there is some specific tweak that can be done in our specific application to make it perform faster. But then we must remember to ask ourselves, do we need this extra piece of performance, and what amount of work would it be to write it on our own and not use some framework? Maybe the framework we are considering supports only one or small subset of programming languages, and we need some application that is completely language independent. So this could be reasons to use sockets instead of an existing framework. But remember, if you do it, you must be sure you really need it. And also, if you would decide to go for sockets instead of some higher abstraction level framework, you should first consider frameworks on the socket abstraction level. An important such framework is, for example, Netty, which provides infrastructure code for communication using non-blocking sockets. It does not introduce any higher abstraction level communication paradigm, but it's just helping code, rids you of writing code that for non-blocking socket communication that is not application specific. But Netty will not be considered further in this course. Instead, we will now start looking at the communication paradigms on higher abstraction levels. So now it's time to finally start looking at communication paradigms on higher abstraction levels than sockets. So this will be ways of communicating relying on sockets somewhere under the hood, but we will not see the sockets at all in our code. This is really a jungle. There are many different paradigms, and there are many different frameworks. So what I'm about to do here is just one way to categorize and explain different paradigms. At the highest level, paradigms are divided into remote invocation and message sending. So let's start with remote invocation. Here we have two nodes, two different network nodes, node 1 and node 2, and the cloud thing in between is supposed to be the network. And in both nodes we have written some code, that's the red thing, our application. The application on node 1 wants to call the application on node 2. The code on node 1 will just make an ordinary method call. Say it wants to call the method met and pass some parameter, for example the string hi. To our code on the application on node 1, it would just look like an ordinary method call. But the method will be handled by the framework. So the framework, I will draw it in green. So there is some code from the framework. How this is supposed to happen, I will explain further on in the next video. So on code on node 1, there is some code related to the framework that we have downloaded and installed. So this framework will receive the method called to the method met and the parameter hi. It will make the network call, which will arrive in framework code residing on node 2. And this framework will call our application on node 2 and make exactly this call to the method met and pass the parameter hi. The application on node 2 will contain some code that has the method met and receives a string parameter. Look now at the red thing, the code we are writing. On the receiver on node 2 we have declared a method called met, and on the sender on node 1 we are calling that method met. So what happens is that a plain method call on one node, node 1, actually calls a method on another node, node 2, but completely transparent to the application code because it's the framework that handles the actual communication. How on earth this is supposed to happen is not perhaps very obvious, but that's the topic of the next video. Now instead let's turn our attention to message sending. This is another communication paradigm. Again we have the two nodes, node 1 and node 2, and we have written application code on both of them, and we have the cloudy network in between. So again the code on node 1 needs to pass the string hi to the code on node 2. But with the message sending paradigm, the node 1 will make a call like send and some kind of address, node 2, some logical identifier of the receiver, and then the parameter hi. So this code is passed to the framework running on node 1, and this call is made to the framework. Here the application on node 1 does not make an ordinary method call, but instead requests the framework to send the message to the logical address node 2, and the message should contain the value hi. So the framework then will send the message to framework code residing on node 2. So now the message arrived at node 2, and then the application can call receive to ask for potential messages, perhaps specifying the sender or perhaps any message, and the framework then would return the hi string as a return value of the call to receive that was made by the application. So another way, alternatively, the application code does not call receive, but instead the application code has previously registered interest in all in receiving any message, or any message from node 1 or whatever filter there is, and then the framework would notify the application code that a message was received and pass the message. This is the message sending paradigm. So here the primitives are send and receive. It's not transparent that there is a network in between. And message sending can be further divided into direct and indirect message sending. So what is done here is in fact direct message sending, where the node 1 sends the message directly to node 2. The alternative indirect message sending would mean that node 1 does not send the message directly to node 2, but instead to another component residing on node 3, another place in the network, which is called a message broker, which then sends the message to node 2. So here node 1 and node 2 are completely decoupled by the message broker. The advantage of the indirect message sending is that now the message broker has more capabilities of routing, and it can also store the message until node 2 becomes active, for example, in case node 2 was not active when the message was sent, perform security checks, store the message in a persistent data store, or whatever. So now let's compare the different communication paradigms. First, let's have a look at remote invocation. So is it transparent? That means, is the application code completely unaffected by the fact that we're doing a remote call? It is, because we can see here that the method call on the sending side, node 1, looks exactly as a local method call. This is called access transparency. A local method call looks just like a remote method call. So the answer was yes. Is there space decoupling? Space decoupling means that sender does not need to know anything about receiver, like IP address or port number or any kind of address. It would seem the answer is yes, the remote invocation has this, but in fact it has not. Looking over here, this method is a plain method call without any reference. But in fact, before this thing happens, the method call that is illustrated here, there must have been some kind of lookup to get the reference. This thing must have been retrieved somehow. So we must have informed the framework beforehand that we need such kind of connection to the framework on node 2. And that operation we have actually specified. The address of node 2. Okay, so more about this later in next video. So the answer is no, there is no space decoupling. What about time decoupling? So time decoupling means that sender and receiver do not need to be active at the same time. That is not the case for remote invocation. If the framework performing the remote call to node 2 cannot reach node 2, there would be a failure. Okay, next property that is being compared is non-functional requirements like persistence, transactions, security. Can the message be persisted? Not really, because if the node 1 or node 2 or both would crash, the message would be lost. Even if the framework somehow stored the message in a database, which would be quite inconvenient, by the way, having to run a database just to make the method call, it could still happen that the node crashed before the message reached the database. So the answer is no, there is no persistency. Also, there is not really much of transaction security. There could be, depends on how complex the framework is, what it actually can perform. But since it is running on node 1 and node 2, it becomes dependent on the state of node 1 and node 2, and if they are up or down. All of these results can perhaps be discussed to some extent. So let's say that normally the answer is like this. So then what about message sending? It is obviously not transparent, since the primitives are send and receive. Send here, receive here. It's obvious to node 1 that it's not doing a local method call, but it is sending a message. Space decoupling, yes, at least if we have message broker, this thing here, because the node 1 now does not need to know anything about node 2's physical location. It's enough to know the message broker. Time decoupling, yes, node 1 and node 2 do not require to be active at the same time. Node 1 can just deliver the message to the message broker, and then node 1 can be shut down before node 2 receives the message from the message broker. Persistence, yes, the message broker can save the message permanently in the database. Then as a comparison, I made a column for plain sockets, and for plain sockets the answer is no to all questions. Of course, it is not transparent. We are establishing connections, sending server sockets and so on. There's no space decoupling, of course. We need the IP address all the time, port number. There's no time decoupling. You cannot send a message to a socket that is down. And of course, TCP has no persistency or transactions or anything like that. Okay, so now it's interesting to summarize this. So we can see that sockets is useless from these perspectives. The only reason to use sockets are those mentioned before, that we need better performance without the overhead of the frameworks, but you should not just assume that the frameworks are slow. You have to measure it. Or that we need to tweak some very specific property of a socket, like some TCP option that the frameworks do not handle. Or maybe that we need to connect to a node written in a programming language that is not supported by the framework. Otherwise, when it comes to these more higher-level abstractions, sockets have nothing to offer. So remote invocation has the promise of the transparency, which is very beautiful, but has the downside of the tight coupling, and message sending is exactly the opposite.